Our
This
next
conference
speaker
will now be recorded.
Is going to giving a delivery on the computational modeling of laser metal IoT manufacturing process. It's my pleasure to introduce our the next speaker, Dr. Srikant Bonta. He is an associate professor in the Mechanical Engineering Department at National Institute of Technology, Karnataka. And Dr. Bonta received PhD in Engineering and MS in Mechanical Engineering degree from Rice State University, Ohio, and an undergraduate degree in Metallurgy Engineering from Jawaharlal Nehru Technological University, Hyderabad, India. He worked as an assistant professor at Indian Institute of Technology, Patna from 2011 to 2013, and also at Temple University, USA, 2009 to 2011. Before beginning his academic career, he spent more than 3 years in the industry at Kenna Metal Incorporation, Pittsburgh, USA, where he led product development projects as well as conducted research in the area of metal cutting. Dr. Srikant Bonta received a research interest including mechanics, materials issues in additive manufacturing and laser processing of materials. He is a recipient of the 2010 Outstanding Young Manufacturing Engineer Award from the Society of Mechanical Engineering. He also recipient of the 2019-2009 Young Leader Professional Development Award from the Minerals, Metals and Materials Society, TMS, and the 2009 American Society for Metals, ASM, as well as Indian Institute of Metals visiting lecturer. He was selected as a represent TMS in the Engineering Leaders Alliances Capstone, a training program at Denver in the November 2010. He holds 3 patents and has published several articles in the top ranking journals and international conference proceedings. Now I am welcoming Dr. Srikant Bonta to deliver his lecture on computational modeling of laser additive manufacturing process. Thank you, professor. Thank you for we are going to welcome our next speaker. Please go ahead, sir.
Good morning. Can you see the screen?
Yes, it's visible.
Okay. So good morning to one and all. My name is Srikant Bonta and I'm an associate professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering at NITK Suratkal. I'll be speaking today about computational modeling of laser metal additive manufacturing process. Before I begin my talk, I would like to thank the organizers of the 6-day online faculty development program on teaching and learning additive manufacturing for giving me an opportunity to share my work. So the outline of my talk would be as follows. I'm going to first introduce you very briefly to laser additive manufacturing process, which I'd like to
Dr. Srikant, sorry to interrupt you. Can you go to the slide? Can you go to the slide mode?
I'm sorry. Just a second, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, is it now in the slide mode, sir?
Yes, fine, sir.
Yeah, thank you. So first and foremost, I'll briefly introduce to laser additive manufacturing process, which henceforth will be referring to as LAM, because I have seen that several speakers have already introduced you to different classes of AM process, in particular to metal AM process. So I'll not be discussing in detail. I will also highlight some key differences between these two classes of LAM process. One is the direct energy deposition, and the second is powder bed fusion process, to highlight the key differences in the way you approach to computationally model this process. Then I'm going to discuss about the complexity of these processes as to why this process is so complex and why optimization of process parameters through experimentation is going to take a long time and also involve significant cost. Then I'm going to discuss about the need for computational modeling, followed by discussing the challenges. What are the challenges that are present when you try to model these processes? Then what are the different LEM skills that we need to consider when you try to computationally model the LAM process? Then I'm going to start talking about the early modeling attempts that were carried out in the early 90s when these processes were first discovered that were based upon models based in welding, which are also known as analytical models, followed by which I'm going to talk about thermomechanical finite element modeling, which will enable us to capture the physics better compared to the analytical models, then I'm going to illustrate some case studies that we have carried out to understand deposit characteristics in this process, and I'll summarize my talk. So as you all know, in laser additive manufacturing process, which is a subset of additive manufacturing, you start with a 3D CAD model, you slice the CAD model into cross-sectional layers, and then you use a laser to melt the powder and then deposit the material layer by layer to form the object. Now, the mechanics of all AM process, they have a similar pattern. Multiple beads lead to the formation of a row, multiple rows lead to the formation of a layer, and multiple layers lead to the formation of the object. So you can see that there's a hierarchy here: beads, then track, then layer, and then the final object. And now, the first metal AM process, they were discovered in the time frame of 94 to 96, and they were commercialized in 1998. So they have essentially evolved from what are known as rapid prototyping process, and they have been developed over the last couple of decades to fabricate parts without the necessity of any tooling in a fast, flexible, and automatic manner. Now we have two classes of LAM process. One class is known as the directed energy deposition process, and the second class of process are known as the powder bed fusion process. Now, one important point I want to highlight here is that these two categories are metal additive manufacturing process. As you know, that the symposium has an emphasis on metal AM, and at the same time, there is electron beam freeform fabrication that belongs to the DED class of process, and electron beam melting that belongs to the powder bed fusion process. So if you, the next slide shows a schematic of the two processes. Again, I'll briefly describe them because they have been discussed in detail by other speakers. So in the direct energy deposition process, you have a substrate on which you focus a high power laser beam. The laser beam creates a molten pool or a melt pool. I'll refer to them as the melt pool or molten pool. And then streams of metallic powder are simultaneously injected into this molten pool through nozzles. And so you have the form, and as the laser traverses to the next position, a bead is formed. By traversing the substrate in the X and Y direction, you form a row of material, a track of material, and by incrementing the laser and the powder delivery and focusing lens assembly in the positive Z direction, you form the next layer. So in this way, you go from a bead to a track to a layer. So here, in the directed energy deposition process was first commercialized by Optomec in 1998, and that process is called the laser engineered net shaping or the lens process. In addition to that, there's another DED process also known as DM3D, and these processes are similar except with some minor variations in the specifications. Then the next class of LAM process is the powder bed fusion process. As you all are aware, in a powder bed fusion process, you have powder that is spread on a bed, and a laser scans the powder based on the CAD model, and then it melts and deposits the powder. You form a layer of material, and then you load the bed, and then you raise the powder feed piston, and then use a roller bed to spread the powder, which forms the powder feed for the next layer, and then you scan this newly spread layer of powder. In this way, you again build the part layer by layer. So some of the key differences between these two processes I'm going to highlight in the next slide. So there are several differences. You can probably write down about 15 to 20 odd differences. I'm only going to highlight some key differences that will enable me to better explain the differences in the computational modeling aspects also. So if you look at the table here, it shows the characteristic, the process. The first one is the direct energy deposition process, which I'm referring to as LDED. And the second one is the powder bed fusion process, which I'm referring to as LPBF. So if you look at the part size, in the direct energy deposition process is capable of handling larger parts and larger and heavier parts. Here, the part size is limited by the handling system. In the case of powder bed fusion process, the part size is limited by the size of the build chamber. And I have given the maximum part size, but I just want to caution that with constant improvements in the machines, these values are also changing. So this is what I've picked from literature. but there's a possibility that this could already change with the machines coming with larger part, bigger build volume and more number of lasers. So instead of a single laser, now you have about three or four lasers, your machines coming up like that. One important aspect that is different between the two processes is the particle size. In the DED process, you use a particle size anywhere between 45 to 150 microns, whereas in the powder bed fusion process, the particle size is about between 20 to 50 microns. So in the powder bed fusion process, the particle size is much smaller compared to DED. That's an important aspect that you need to consider when you look for simulation of this process. The next aspect is the beam size. In the DED process, the beam spot size, the beam diameter is larger compared to PBF. Here, it's about 0.5 to 4 mm, whereas in the powder bed fusion process, it's anywhere between 50 to 200 microns. The layer thickness, again, is larger in DED process, which is obvious, which is from 500 to 1000 microns, whereas it is much smaller in powder bed, going from 25 to 50 microns. Another important aspect is that if you want to build a component, if you want to build or deposit material in a DED process, you can do it on any 3D surface or on existing parts. Whereas in a powder bed fusion process, the general limitation is that you need a flat surface or a flat preform. Hence, powder bed fusion processes are not generally used for repair of components because of the limitation that you need to have a flat surface or a flat preform. And the last significant difference is that in DED process, the scan speeds are very low compared to powder bed fusion. They're about the maximum scan speed in the order of 50 mm per second. Whereas in powder bed fusion process, the scan speeds are about the maximum scan speeds go up to 1000 mm per second. So you can see that two important aspects can be seen here. One is powder bed fusion has much smaller particle size. And the second aspect is powder bed fusion has much larger scan speeds. And these two play a role in terms of increasing the complexity of modeling of the powder bed fusion process. Okay, so as I said, the first metal AM process were developed between 94 to 96. And right from the time of the development, these laser additive manufacturing or LAMP process, they have proved beyond doubt that they can be very useful manufacturing techniques, especially when you have low volume production, that is a short run or low volume production. They are good for repairing of components, particularly DED, because it can deposit material on 3D parts or existing surfaces, addition of detailed elements to generic components, like addition of features, and fabrication of functionally grade materials. Again, here DED scores much better to compared to powder bed fusion. So they have really proved that they can be useful manufacturing techniques in different areas of application, ranging from aerospace to biomedical to tooling industry and so on. However, there have been some obstacles to the widespread commercialization of these processes. And these obstacles come in terms of the need for consistency of build conditions that is expressed in terms of the melt pool size, the need for avoiding tolerance loss and decreased reliability of the component that is expressed in terms of controlling the residual stress that is evolved in these components, and the need for obtaining consistent mechanical properties that are comparable to wrought or cast components, and that is related to controlling of the microstructure that is obtained in these deposited components. So now I'm going to discuss briefly about the complexity of this process. So if you look at either the direct energy deposition DED or powder bed fusion PBF processes, in both these processes, you have a number of physical phenomena that are occurring at the same time. You have heat transfer, you have fluid mechanics, you have melting of the powder, solidification, solid state phase transformations, grain growth, diffusion, continuum mechanics, all of this various physical phenomena are occurring simultaneously or sequentially. And several process variations are possible. As I said, if you take the powder bed fusion process, for example, the initial machines came with only a single laser. Then came developments where you had two lasers. Now there are some machines that have four lasers to increase the productivity. So several process variations are possible in terms of the number of lasers, in terms of the process parameters, and in terms of the materials that can be processed. And then you have a large number of deposit characteristics that need to be understood. So for example, I discussed three important deposit characteristics in the last slide when I was talking about obstacles. One is the melt pool size when you're trying to control the build conditions. One is residual stress when you want to minimize any decreased reliability of the component, as well as warping or distortion when you try to machine the component. And the last one is obtaining a consistent microstructure for consistency mechanical properties. And the complexity in this process will also result from a large number of variables. Now the variables can come from the system or they can come from the process. So if you look at the process parameters, for example, you have several process parameters. I have listed some of them here. The process parameters can go from the power of the laser, the scan speed. What if you are looking at DED, what is the powder feed flow rate? Powder flow rate may not make, does not have much meaning in powder bed fusion process. What is the hatch width, the hatch spacing? What is the deposition pattern? Are you using a unidirectional pattern, a multidirectional pattern, or a zigzag pattern? What is the substrate temperature? Is it preheated? What is the inlet gas flow rate? And what are the kind of treatments that these components are being subject to post deposition, including one of the treatment is HIP, hot isostatic pressing, to minimize porosity, or heat treatment to improve the properties. Now the input material is powder. Now you have a process that also incorporate wire. For example, you have the wire arc additive manufacturing, also known as WAM. But I'll restrict my talk to powder. So you are looking at what is the powder shape, what is the particle size, morphology, chemical composition, powder flowability. Then when you talk about the substrate, you're looking at what is the chemistry of substrate, what is the preheat temperature, what's the microstructure, the inlet gas, are you using argon or using nitrogen. So there are several of these variations that are possible in these processes. Now additional complexity also arises due to large number of deposit characteristics that need to be understood. So I've listed many of them here. So you have the dimensions of the melt pool. You're also looking at the evolution of stress in the deposit, the lack of fusion between layers, the gas porosity that comes from the powder particles, or the lack of fusion porosity between the layers. Then what's the microstructure, chemical composition, and so on. So as I said, the complexity in this process is due to a large number of process parameters, large number of deposit characteristics that need to be understood, as well as the several variations that are possible in both the system as well as in the process. So now I have just tried to summarize whatever I have said in the form of a flowchart. If you see here, the various inputs can come from the energy source. So if you also include electron beam processes, then energy source becomes important. Okay, so the inputs can be in the form of the beam power, the beam size, the beam angle at which, and the pattern, the travel speed, the time between scans, and so on. The inputs can also come from the powder, as we have discussed earlier. A couple of important properties that I did not touch in my previous slide is the absorptivity of the powder bed material. So different materials have different absorptivity. So we need to consider that as an important parameter, and the recycling of powder. So generally the powder costs are the significant cost of the metal AM process. So the OEMs, they always tend to use the powder multiple times. So the question is, at what point the powder should not be used, the recycled powder should not be used further. Then you have substrate, and then you have the build atmosphere. So these are all the inputs, and the deposition process, as I said, several multitude complex phenomena are happening together, including melt pool dynamics. There is the interaction between the heat source, which is the laser, and the powder material. There is melting taking place, there is solidification taking place, so there's a phase change. Then you have the building of the geometry, the thermal stress evolution, and so on. And last but not the least, you have the various deposit characteristics, and including the mechanical properties that need to be determined after you deposit the component. So you can see that there are a large number of inputs to these processes, which increase the complexity, as well as there are a large number of outputs that need to be, which are the key deposit characteristics that need to be understood to obtain a good quality part. So one of the biggest concerns in the area of metal additive manufacturing is the part quality. Now, if you look at conventional manufacturing processes, they have standards for qualification certification. However, when you look at additive manufacturing, the ASTM set up a committee in 2009, and that committee came up with the coined term additive manufacturing, and that committee has set up several subcommittees which are looking into standards for qualification and certification, and that process is currently ongoing. So at this point of time, There is a clear standards for qualification certification have not been established for the complex combinations of the various machines, materials, processes, and techniques that are used in process. So what happens here is that the absence of the reliable database will result in the OEMs having lower confidence to adapt additive manufacturing processes in some critical industries, particularly in the aerospace industry, where you have strict guidelines on mechanical properties. Now, these potential issues in terms of establishing the standards can come from the multiple length and time scales that are involved in the building process, which I'll discuss a little bit in detail in my later slides. So, what is the need for computational modeling? Okay, which we can also call it as process simulation. So now, traditional approach for part qualification, how do you do that? You do experimentation. That experimentation, you conduct a large number of trials. So that makes it both time consuming and expensive. So this, to create a reliable database, you need a large number of trials. That makes it pretty expensive and it may take several years to complete. And now, as you have seen in additive manufacturing, you have several variables that affect the key deposit characteristics. Then you have the machine design variables, the process design variables and all, which will complicate the qualification procedure. Therefore, the computational modeling can play a very important role in the qualification of metallic parts that are produced by additive manufacturing process. Now, one of the main goal for computational modeling really is to minimize the trial and error approach for optimization of process parameters. So in the early days when metal AM process were developed in the 1990s, 94 to 98 time frame, most of the work was done by trial and error approach. And people realized that this trial and error approach will not work when you go from one material to another material or when you go from one part to another part. That is when they realized that this approach is for optimization of process parameters is both time consuming and expensive. And they started looking at ways where they can understand the process physics by using computational modeling. Now, one advantage that modeling has is that modeling enables you to understand the process physics better. Okay, once you understand the process physics better, you will be able to better control the build conditions that will enable you to control the melt pool size. A consistent melt pool size is required for the fabrication of the desired features. And a minimal residual stress is required for reducing the tolerance loss and any warping or distortion. And you need to control the microstructure to obtain better and consistent mechanical properties that are comparable with parts that are produced from casting or from the metal forming processes. And computational modeling also enables you to obtain information such as maximum temperature, temperature distribution, thermal cycling that is undergone by each layer, the distribution of residual stress, cooling rates, thermal gradients, that may be extremely challenging or difficult to measure experimentally. Therefore, modeling and simulation can be used as a facilitating tool to understand comprehensively the effect of the deposition process parameters on the key characteristics of the deposit and thereby alleviate or reduce the need for extensive experimentation. Now, okay, so now we are talking about computational modeling, but there are several challenges here. Okay, if you look at it, additive manufacturing is nothing but multi-pass welding. Okay, you are depositing several passes, which can be some hundreds or thousands of passes, layers. So when the metal AM process were first developed in the late 90s, people looked at welding to see if they could use the welding process models to understand the AM process phenomena. So some of the challenges in the computational modeling of AM process I'm listing here. The first challenge is, how do we model the addition of material? In welding, you may not encounter this challenge, but in additive manufacturing, as you are building the material component in a layer by layer manner, one of the biggest challenges is, how do you model the addition of material? Then, now we are going to use heat sources in additive manufacturing. The heat source can be a laser, it can be continuous, or it's pulsed. So how do you model the heat input? Okay, that's coming from the laser. Now, these processes are taking place in an inert atmosphere, or open atmosphere, depending upon the material that's being processed. So how do we accurately account for the thermal losses that take place during building? It has been widely accepted in additive manufacturing that the main mode of heat transfer or heat loss is by conduction through the substrate. The substrate acts as heat sink. Okay, but still, how do we account for all the other modes of heat loss, such as convection, radiation, evaporation, and so on? Then how do we account for the elastoplastic stresses and strains? Now, as the magnitude of the residual stresses increases beyond the yield stress, then there's going to be some elastoplastic strains, plastic strains. So how do we account for the elastoplastic stresses and strains? Now, the thermal response in additive manufacturing causes a mechanical response. So temperature is causing the mechanical response. So how do we couple this thermal and the mechanical behavior in a manageable way to understand the magnitude and distribution of residual stresses? Now, if you consider material, the properties of the material are going to vary from room temperature up to the melting temperature. In metal AM process, we are going to melt the material and then the material solidifies. So there is a phase change involved. How do we account for the temperature dependence of material properties right from the room temperature till the melting temperature, and then accounting for the latent heat effects called the phase change? Then how do we account for the various complex physical phenomena that are occurring in these processes, right from the fluid mechanics, continuum mechanics, melting, solidification, grain growth, solid state phase transformations? So you have heat transfer, fluid mechanics, solid mechanics, material science in the form of solid state phase transformations, grain growth, all occurring simultaneously or sequentially. And how much of the physical phenomena are you going to capture in the model? So these are the challenges. So I'm going to discuss all these challenges in a little bit more detail as we proceed further. And one of the last challenges that, as I mentioned earlier, additive manufacturing process involve multiple length and time scales. Well, what do you mean by this? Let's say, for example, we consider the powder particles. The powder particles can be anywhere from 20 microns to 150 microns, depending upon whether you're looking at powder bed fusion or DD process. Now, if you look at the DD, the laser beam can be anywhere from 70 microns to 0.5 millimeters and so on. Now, the dimensions of the workpiece can be anywhere in cubic centimeters or in cubic meters. So you have different length scales here, starting from microns of the powder particle size to millimeters of the laser beam spot size to cubic centimeters or meters for the dimensions of the workpiece. And the build time can be anywhere from a few hours to several days to several weeks. So all this metal AM process, they will span different length and time scales that need to be accounted in the computational model. So I have taken one example from an AM handbook, which has given the time, estimated computer time for a simple simulation. The build height was about 100 millimeters. The computational time step was about 10 microseconds. The layer thickness was 20 microns. The number of layers was 5,000. And the actual build time was 20 hours in a machine. And the number of computational time steps, if you do it mathematically, if you're doing it numerically using a software, is about 7.2 times 10 raised to 9. And the estimated computer time was several days with GPU machine. So you can see that for a small deposit, you need several days with high-end computing workstations. So that brings to one of the big challenges of computational modeling of laser additive manufacturing process is that completing the simulations in a useful time frame. See, when you do a simulation, the whole idea of doing simulation is to cut down the time and cost of optimization of process parameters. So you should be able to get the entire simulation results in a small fraction of the build time. So you should be able to do large number of simulations and we arrive at the optimal process conditions before you start depositing the first part. But if your simulation time is going to take you weeks or months, then the industry will question the usefulness of the simulation studies and will accept the experimental method for optimization of process parameters. Because if your simulation is going to take you weeks or months, that will not help the industry to reduce the time and cost of product development. Therefore, one important challenge is related to in the computational modeling is completing the simulations in a useful time frame. That is, in a time frame that will enable you to carry out the process optimization in a quick and rapid manner. So there are, as I said, These LAMP processes, they cover different length and time scales. Okay, so now the chart here shows the different length and time scales that are generally used in the LAMP process. As you can see here, there are different length scales starting from the micro scale, which goes from 10 raised to minus 9 meters, nanometers, to 10 raised to minus 6 meters. The particle scale that goes from 10 raised to minus 6 meters, microns, to 10 raised to minus 3 meters. The mesoscale, that's 10 raised to minus 3 meters. And the macro scale, that's from 10 raised to minus 3 to 1 meter. Now, you can see that as the length scale decreases, the complexity of the simulation, as well as the complexity of the data that's required, increases. And this also increases the computational cost exponentially. Now, I will briefly highlight upon some of the important length scales. The first length scale is the micro scale, that is from nanometers to 10 raised to minus 6 meters as microns. Here, you use what are known as the phase field models to predict the microstructure of the solidified material. So, modeling at this scale includes understanding solidification, solid state phase transformations, the grain coarsening mechanisms, and so on. Some of the softwares that are used for simulations at this scale include JMAT Pro, ThermoCalc, etc. Okay. Now, these different length scales, they are also nowadays being called as integrated computational materials engineering. That is, integrating the modeling at different material length scales. So, the first length scale predicts the microstructure of the solidified metal, and here you discuss about solidification, solid state phase transformations, and so on. The second length scale talks about the consolidation of the individual powder particles into dense material. These simulations are referred to as particle scale. Okay, at this scale, you also study the interaction between the beam and the powder particles. The techniques that are commonly used at the particle scale include what are known as the 2D lattice Boltzmann technique and the discrete element method. So you have stellar automaton modeling of discrete particle kinetics, and discrete element method is a numerical method which is capable of handling individual particles of any shape in a continuous domain. However, these simulations are computationally expensive. The mesoscale. The work that I'm going to present in this presentation, the simulations are all from the meso and the macro scale length scales. The mesoscale looks at investigating the interaction between the beam and the material, the transient melt pool, and the evolution of temperatures as you build a single track or as you are building several layers, the thermal cycling in the layers. So this is what we're going to look at the mesoscale. Here you're looking at the flow in the melt pool. So the flow can be because of buoyancy, the flow can be because of surface tension, which is also known as thermocapillary flow or Barangoni flow. And the last scale is the macro scale, which is 10 raised to minus 3 to 1 meter. The goal here is to carry out thermomechanical simulations to predict the residual stress distribution of the component, as well as the distortion of components. The goal of the simulations is to look at how the residual stress evolves during deposition and what happens when you take the component and what is the distortion expected after deposition. Some of the softwares that are available for simulations at this scale include ANSYS, Abacus, COMSOL, etc. Okay, so now, till this point of time, I have discussed about the different LAMP processes, the key differences, the need for computational modeling, some of the challenges in the computational modeling, and the different length scales that are available to model the LAMP processes. Now I'm going to discuss about the various challenges that I presented to earlier. The first challenge that I had talked about was, how do you account for the addition of material? As I said earlier, additive manufacturing is nothing but multi-pass welding. But the big significant difference is that you need to account for the addition of new material. So people have used a technique known as element birth and death technique for addition of material in these LAMP processes. So what essentially happens in this element birth and death technique is that you either activate or birth the elements, or you deactivate or kill the elements. And how do we do this? How do we activate the elements and how do we kill the elements? So what happens here is that all the elements corresponding to the model, they are present from the start of the simulation. So initially, all the elements are deactivated or killed. How do we do that? To kill an element, what we do is we multiply its material properties like stiffness and thermal conductivity by a significant reduction factor known as a scaling factor. The scaling factor is on the order of 10 raised to minus 6. So what happens in that case is that these elements do not contribute to the global matrices in the finite element system of equations. Okay, so how do we kill an element? We kill an element by multiplying its material properties, their thermal conductivity and specific heat, by a scaling factor on the order of 10 raised to minus 6. Okay, so essentially elements are not removed from the model, they are only inactivated or deactivated or killed. So here, using a schematic, I'm showing the element birth and death technique. If you look at the schematic on the bottom, you can see there are three classes of elements. One is the active elements, elements that are active, that is elements that are contributing to the finite element system of equations. Now there is an element that is being newly active, where the laser beam is, that is being activated, and there are several elements in front of that which are inactive, which implies they are part of the, they are physically part of the model, but they are not contributing to the global stiffness matrix and equations because their material properties have been multiplied by a significant reduction factor. So you have three types of elements: active elements, activated elements, and inactive elements. Now the schematic on the top shows the activation process. So in step one, so I have a substrate and I'm depositing the first row of element, first row of material. So I'm activating the elements corresponding to the location of the laser beam. So you can see in step one, the elements that are activated, in step two, the elements that are activated, and in step three, the elements that are activated. Activation of elements simply implies that we are bringing back the material properties of those elements back to their original values. That is, we are bringing them to the original thermal conductivity and specific heat values. Now, important point to note is that the inactive elements have not been removed from the model. They are only simply inactivated so that they don't contribute to the global stiffness matrix equations. Okay. So when we are implementing this element birth and death technique, important point is all the elements are present in the model right from the start of the simulation. Only those elements corresponding to the deposition are activated as the laser moves based on the defined path. And the elements are activated based upon the movement of the laser. So moving to the next slide. So the first challenge was modeling the addition of material. The second challenge is modeling the heat input. Now, we all know that the heat in metal AM process comes from the laser. Or it can also, if you are using electron beam process, it can be electron beam. So in the lamp process, we use a laser. This laser melts the powders and consolidates them together with the substrate. So in the early days, when the metal AM process was being developed, people went back to literature to see if there existed any models that can be used to understand the effect of process parameters on the key deposit characteristics. So naturally, they first went back to welding because AM is nothing but multi-pass welding, and they identified some models that can be used for LED manufacturing process. And these heat source models are classified into three generations because now it's about two decades right from the time the first AM metal AM process was developed. So the heat source models are classified into three generations: the first generation heat source models, the second generation heat source models, and other models. So what do you mean by this? In the first generation, people used the heat source models that were proposed by Rosenthal for welding in 1946 and Brackley in 1974, which use analytical models to compute the thermal history. Okay, so these are analytical solution or closed form solution. Now these analytical models, they come with a large number of assumptions, and they work very well for simple geometries, and they can predict, they can give a good prediction of temperature away from the heat source. But they come with a large number of assumptions, which I'll discuss a little bit later in detail. Now, one key point to note is that in analytical models, you are neglecting the nonlinear effects, that is, the temperature variation of material properties and phase transformation, they are ignored. And these analytical models, they can only determine the temperature field under steady state conditions, that is, when the laser has reached the center of a wall, where the temperature field does not change significantly. If you look at an AM process, and you can clearly see that as the laser traverses towards the edge of the geometry, the size of the molten pool increases. This is because the area available for heat conduction decreases, and conduction is the dominant mode of heat transfer in LAMP process. These first generation heat source models, which were analytical models, they were incapable of predicting the transient temperature distribution, which is the norm in the additive manufacturing process. The first generation heat source models used a point heat source or a line heat source. The second generation heat source models used a distributed heat flux model. And this distributed heat flux model improves the accuracy of temperature prediction in and around the melt pool. Now we have different heat flux models. You have a surface Gaussian heat flux model, you have a double ellipsoid distribution, and so on. So different heat flux models have been used. Okay, the most widely used heat flux model in the simulation of a LAMP process is the Gaussian distributed heat flux model. And this is mainly used because of the small penetration depth of the laser beam. So the heat flux model, as I said, which is most commonly used, is the Gaussian heat flux model, which is given here. You have F is 2 alpha q by pi r square, exponential minus 2, and you have the term there. Now, let me define the terms here. F is applied heat flux. Alpha is the energy absorption coefficient, that is, what fraction of the laser energy is absorbed by the material. Q is the laser power in watts. R is the laser spot radius. And X and Y are variables which define the distance from the center of the laser beam. And at the bottom, I have also given a table that shows the different heat flux equations that are generally used in laser additive manufacturing process. You can see that in the surface heat flux itself, there are different variations depending upon the characteristics such as absorptivity and different shapes of Gaussian distribution that are used. And then you have a volumetric heat source where optical penetration depth is also considered. Now, one of the challenges in the modeling of the laser additive manufacturing process is, what is the laser absorption coefficient, alpha? Because that will determine the fraction of the laser energy that's absorbed by the deposit. Now, the laser absorption coefficient is a very complex parameter. The reason being that it depends upon several factors. The first is the material. So if you take two materials, this titanium and aluminium, titanium has got a higher absorption compared to aluminium, which is highly reflective. Therefore, it has got lower absorption. So the first factor that the absorption coefficient depends upon is the material. The absorption coefficient also depends upon the surface toughness. It depends upon if any oxide films are formed on the surface. It depends on temperature. It depends upon the wavelength of the laser beam. So if you use an NDAG laser beam versus CO2 laser beam, you have different wavelengths. So the absorption coefficient changes. Generally, NDAG laser have better absorption coefficient than CO2 lasers. It depends on the angle of incidence, the time of interaction, the particle's powder size and distribution, and the spot size and profile. So you can see that the laser absorption coefficient, alpha, depends upon several factors, and it is a very complex parameter to determine. And it is one of the key parameters that is required for the simulation of this laser additive manufacturing process. Now, as I said, there are other heat source models. In the early days, when the simulation of LAMP process was being looked into, people only considered conduction because that was the easiest model to solve. And also, it was determined that conduction is the dominant mode of heat transfer. 80% of the energy from the laser is dissipated by conduction through substrate, which acts as a heat sink. However, with constant improvements in computational power and algorithms and softwares and all, people have now started taking into account the effects such as fluid dynamics, buoyancy, surface tension forces. Surface tension, or the Marangoni effect or thermocapillary flow, is considered to be the most dominant effect which determines the shape of the molten pool. And so if you want to accurately predict, capture the shape of the molten pool, you need to incorporate surface tension effects. So fluid flow and heat transfer are both important to determine the size and shape of the molten pool, as well as for the macro and microstructures of the lamp deposit components. In the early days, these were not the fluid dynamics, surface tension effects, buoyancy effects were not included because of the mathematical difficulties to obtain a solution, or you required additional coefficient values such as surface tension viscosity, surface tension gradient, so on, which were not easy to obtain, that you had to determine experimentally. So they neglected the effect of these parameters. But with in today's age, if you want to determine the shape of the molten pool accurately, it's important to also incorporate the effects of fluid dynamics, buoyancy, and surface tension. Okay. I just want to ask the organizers if we should have a small question answer session before the first break, or should I continue? Hello?
You can give a break, no problem.
No, I can take any questions if they have, and then we can take a break.
Yeah, if there are any questions, you can. Dear participants, if you have any questions, please ask the speaker.
Hello. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, I am asking about that. If you have a laser surface processing modeling of laser surface processing, so that will be the same concept, just like you are explaining in this slide. If you want to model for laser surface processing.
Yes. See, the thing is, it depends on what you're looking at. Are you looking at laser melting only, or are you looking at laser cladding where there is additional material? So if this, the one that I'm talking about here, can be applied to laser cladding directly, because you are adding only one or two layers of material and with small thickness. For surface melting, there is no additional material. You are just making a laser scan. So you don't have to use the element birth and death technique. The rest of the modeling procedures would be similar, except that you don't have to use the element birth and death technique. For welding, it depends upon the number of passes. If it's multi-pass welding, yes, you can use the EBD technique and the rest of the modeling procedures in a similar manner.
Mm-hmm. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning.
Like, what should be the suitable particle size to get a good defectless product?
See, the particle size to get a good defectless product is, the particle size plays a very important role in the flowability and all. So particle size is determined by the process you're using. For example, when you look at powder bed, they're using a particle size between 20 to 50 microns. And there you can see that the layer thickness is smaller than you when compared to DED. But in DED, you're using larger particle size.
Okay.
I don't think the defective product, good defective product, will depend upon just the particle size. It is a combination of several factors.
Okay.
Okay.
Can we do a simulation based on the particle size and determine the size which is suitable for the product?
Yes, you can do simulation of particle size. That simulations would be at the particle size scale, which is from 10 okay. raised to minus 6 meters to 10 raised to minus 3. So you have to use something called discrete element method or lattice Boltzmann technique to see the consolidation of powder particles.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, I have one question.
Yes, please.
Will you show any practical example, like using element birth technique, birth death technique, using ANSYS or some COMSOL software?
Yeah, in the later half of my presentation, I'm going to present some case studies that we have done. And when I'm presenting those case studies, you'll be seeing the usage of this element birth and death technique.
Okay, okay. Any practical example, like using ANSYS, how to apply this model?
Yes, we have done some work in the area of direct energy deposition process, and also some work in the area of which I'll be presenting as case studies.
Okay, okay. Thank you, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, as you said, we can find cooling rates. How can we do that, sir?
See, what you have to do is, for example, if you want to determine the cooling rate at a node in your finite element model, you have to record the time and temperature distribution at that node during the both the heating and the cooling stages. And in the cooling stage, you can determine the average value of cooling rate from the solidus and liquidus temperatures, as well as the time at the solidus and time at the liquidus temperature. I have an equation that I'll show you in the later, the second half of the presentation, which shows how to determine the cooling rate. But the simple answer is, you have to determine the cooling rate from the time temperature history of a node.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello. Hello, sir. I have a doubt.
Yes, please go ahead.
When we are printing in powder bed fusion, environment will be different. For example, we might be using nitrogen or argon or helium or something. So when we are simulating these kind of processes, can we consider all those gas things? What's the environment in which it's printing?
Yes, you can consider. See, as I said, there have been constant improvements in the computational models itself. So you can consider. But the question is, there is a trade-off because of the time. So there is a trade-off between what physics you consider and what physics you neglect. So if you believe that the gas flow is affecting any key deposit characteristic, then you definitely would want to consider it.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Hello, sir, there is a one question in the chat box. Sir.
Okay.
Is there a separate model in macro size simulation software like Abacus, ANSYS, etc. is asking, sir.
Well, can you please repeat the question, Dr. Majay?
Is there any separate model in macro size simulation software like Abacus, ANSYS?
As far as my knowledge goes, ANSYS has come up with a software called ANSYS Additive Print, and that is mainly to predict the residual stress distribution and distortion in powder bed fusion processes. So that software is called ANSYS Additive Print, and that software can be used for simulating powder bed fusion. And I have not used it myself personally, but I heard that in that what they do is they take a number of layers and bunch them together to reduce the complexity of simulation. So you have this software called ANSYS Additive Print, and in addition to that, you have a software called SimuFact that is there for welding and forming. They also have a software for additive manufacturing, SimuFact AM. And there are other softwares now coming up from, one is from ANSYS, one is from SimuFact, and there's one more software that has come from Autodesk. I don't remember the name. So there are few softwares, but these softwares are more so for powder bed fusion process.
Sir, there is a one more question. EBD technique is generic or contained any specific model is asking.
See, EBD technique is nothing new because it has been used for several years in other areas of simulation. The only thing is when we are using EBD technique in additive manufacturing, we cannot use it directly. We can use it like manually, but it becomes very tedious. Therefore, in that case, you may have to go and write your own macros to come up with an automated version for the EBD technique.
Okay, sir. So Sir, there is a one more question from Dr. Shiva Ramakrishna. Can we model composite particles in powder bed fusion, is asking.
Composite particles in powder bed fusion, see, they can be modeled. The only challenge is that you have to then couple the particle scale simulations with the mesoscale simulations and the macro scale simulations. So you have to do what are known as the lattice Boltzmann or discrete element method, and then couple that with the finite element method. So it is going to be challenging, but it is possible, because the constant improvements in computational power and resources as a software is enabling you to do it.
Sir, can we consider two different particle size length scales? For example, say micron size particles and nano size particles together.
See, again, to be honest, I have not done these kind of simulations, because these simulations are mainly at the particle scale. There are 10 raised to minus 6 or lower. We have not gone to that scale. But I'm sure you can handle particles with different size distribution, but I'm not very sure if you can handle particles with size distribution of orders of magnitude, like micron size scale and nano size scale. I'm not very sure on that. Particles with a micron size distribution, like you have like from 20 microns to 140 microns, you can probably handle that. But going to nanoscale, I'm not very sure. I have to check that.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir, shall we give 5 minutes break, or you can continue?
You can take a break. You can take the planned break time, then we can start again.
Okay, sir. We'll start at 12:25, sir.
Well, the time now is about 12:18.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can start 12:25. We can start.
Okay, sir. Fine. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello.
Sir, shall we start, sir?
Yeah, we can go. We can get started. Yeah. Are all of the participants ready?
Yeah, are there, sir? Please go ahead.
Okay. So, welcome back. So, as I said, we have discussed two challenges in the computational modeling of LAMP process. First one was accounting for the addition of material during this process. The second one was accounting for the energy of the heat source. The next challenge is, how do you model the heat transfer during the LAMP process? Because as we are aware, here you are consolidating material in specific regions that is based upon the part geometry. How are you consolidating the material? By using a heat source that is a laser. Now, the energy from the laser is absorbed by the material, and that energy is dissipated by either conduction, convection, or radiation. So now we look at the energy balance equation in a closed system with respect to the first law of thermodynamics, which can be expressed as Q with a subscript L equal to Q Td, which is the heat loss due to conduction, Q with a subscript Cv, heat loss due to convection, and Q with a subscript R, that is the heat loss due to radiation. So the total energy is energy loss due to convection, conduction, radiation. As I said earlier, in the earlier days, to simplify the simulations, people only considered conduction as the source of heat loss. This is because it was shown mathematically that 80% of the energy from the laser is dissipated by conduction through the substrate, which acts as a heat sink, and the rest of the modes, such as convection, radiation, evaporation, they all constitute the remaining 20%, and hence several of them were neglected to reduce the complexity of the simulations. However, with increase in computing power and with increase in the ability to handle the ability to get data regarding other material properties and all, now the simulations in the current time, they also include the convective flows in the melt pool, radiation, evaporation, and so on. So again, the heat conduction equation according to Fourier's law is described. I think all of you are familiar with this equation, so I'll not describe in detail. So here a couple of important points are: K is the thermal conductivity, Cp is the specific heat, and T is the interaction time between the beam and the material. Now, if you want, as I said, we have a phase change from solid to liquid during melting and from liquid to solid during the solidification. And to capture this phase change, we need to account for enthalpy. So enthalpy change dH is given by Cp dT. So when you include enthalpy change, the conduction equation becomes so on. The initial conditions are that we have an initial temperature for the substrate. So we define the initial temperature substrate at the room temperature, or in case you are preheating the substrate as an electron beam process or using a resistive heater and laser beam process, you can define a preheat temperature of the substrate. The heat losses due to convection radiation are defined as a boundary condition for the free surface of the path, and you have the convection term on the left side and the radiation term on the right side of the equation. So for this, you need to input the convective heat transfer coefficient. And one of the important parameters that you need to know to incorporate radiation is the emissivity. So these are the reasons why in the early days, people neglected convection radiation, because they did not have the data of emissivity and in some cases heat transfer coefficient and so on. Okay, so the next aspect of the simulation is coupling the thermomechanical behavior. What do you mean by this? Now, for example, if I want to determine the temperature distribution in the deposit, I can just do a transient thermal analysis. The transient thermal analysis enables me to determine the temperature distribution. But if I want to also determine the residual stress distribution and the distortional part, I need to do a mechanical analysis. Now, if you look at additive manufacturing process, the thermal response is responsible for the mechanical behavior. Temperature change, temperature is responsible for the mechanical behavior. So you have temperature change causing the mechanical response. So now you have a thermomechanical behavior. This thermomechanical behavior generally can be handled in two ways. In one way, you couple the thermomechanical behavior. In the second way, you uncouple it. Let me explain to you what I mean. So I'm separating the thermal behavior, I'm separating the mechanical behavior. In the uncoupled manner, what we mean is that the thermal behavior affects the mechanical behavior, but the mechanical behavior does not affect the thermal behavior. What do you mean by that? Upstream here affects the downstream, but downstream does not affect the upstream. So uncoupled analysis takes place sequentially. You first do the thermal analysis completely. You determine the temperatures at each node as a function of time. And then once you complete the thermal analysis, you input these temperatures at each node as a function of time as a load in the mechanical analysis. So the uncoupled analysis is performed sequentially. You first do a thermal analysis and then you do the mechanical analysis. Now, when you do this, you have some loss of accuracy, because in additive manufacturing, it takes place simultaneously. You have temperature change causing the stress evolution. So when you do uncoupled, that is when you do this analysis sequentially, there will be some loss of accuracy. However, the coupled analysis you do simultaneously. The thermal analysis affects the mechanical analysis, and mechanical analysis affects the thermal analysis. Let me explain you. The temperature change causes residual stress, and this stress, when it exceeds the yield stress, there will be some plastic deformation. That plastic deformation is converted to heat, and that heat will be used in the calculation of the temperature field. So both the thermal analysis and the mechanical analysis, they're performed together. So you first do the thermal analysis, then do the mechanical analysis in the same step. They're performed together. So this is challenging because you have to change the element type. In the thermal analysis, you use one element type. In the mechanical analysis, you use one element type, and you have to do the analysis together. Well, when you uncouple the analysis, you first perform the thermal analysis, and then you take the output of thermal analysis as a load into the mechanical analysis. So this is the key difference between coupling and uncoupling. Okay, I have just discussed this point, so I'll go further. But if you ask me the question, a coupled analysis is accurate. But if you look at literature, most of the work reported in literature is uncoupled, because it's much more easier to implement it, and it is computationally less time consuming, despite some loss of accuracy in the results. So the uncoupled analysis workflow is as follows. First, you do a thermal analysis. You save the results of thermal analysis as a file name, as jobname.rth. What does it contain? It contains the nodal temperatures as a function of time at every node in the model. Now, these nodal temperatures are input as a load into the structural analysis. And then you carry out the structural analysis, and that structural analysis gives you a output called jobname.rst, which gives you output as stress and displacement. So in the thermal analysis, you input initial conditions, boundary conditions, load, material properties and all. And the same thing goes in structural analysis. I'll discuss in more detail as to what you need to input in each analysis. Now, till this point, we have discussed about what is the need for computational modeling of additive manufacturing, laser additive manufacturing process, and what are the complexities in the laser additive manufacturing process. Now, I'm going to discuss briefly about analytical modeling. Now, analytical modeling, as you all know, it's like a closed form solution. You're obtaining a closed form solution. Analytical modeling is only possible in very simple cases. You have to make a lot of assumptions. So when the metal AM process was first developed at Sandia National Laboratories in 1996, LEMS was developed in 1996, they were looking for models that will enable them to understand what is the magnitude of cooling rates, what is the magnitude of temperature when I deposit stainless steel, when I deposit titanium, for example. So it's not easy to measure them experimentally. So they went back to literature and they found a solution in literature called Rosenthal solution that was given in 1946 for welding. They used the Rosenthal solution to predict temperature distribution, cooling rates, and thermal gradients. And as I'll show you a little later, this Rosenthal solution, in spite of several assumptions, does a decent job in predicting the different process output characteristics. So I'm presenting the Rosenthal solution for a simple geometry, which is known as a thin wall geometry. This Rosenthal solution is a first generation heat source model that uses analytical method to calculate the thermal history. So there are several assumptions. The first assumption is that the material properties are constant. That is, they don't change with temperature. The next assumption is that latent heat, that is, the effect of phase change, is neglected. The next assumption is geometries are finite or infinite. That is, the melt pool does not see the effect of the free edges. geometries are either finite or infinite. And the last assumption is the speed of the moving heat source and the rate of heat input is constant. So let us say there is a, it's a quasi-stationary state. What do you mean by quasi-stationary state? Suppose let's assume that an observer is traveling with a heat source. The observer will not notice any change in the temperature contours at the, with the heat source. Essentially, it has reached a steady state case. So the dimensionless form of the Rosenthal solution is given by T bar equal to e power x naught bar k naught bar times exponential k naught bar root over x naught bar square plus z naught bar square. Here k naught bar is a modified Bessel function of the second time in order zero, and you have a dimensionless temperature on the left side, which is defined in terms of the material properties and process parameters such as power, and material properties such as thermal conductivity and wall thickness, and the spatial coordinates x naught and z naught. They are also defined in terms of material properties and they are defined in terms of material properties and process parameters. Now T is the temperature at the location x naught z naught relative to the moving point source. The point heat source is moving. We are assuming that the laser has a point, is a point heat source. T naught is the initial temperature of the wall. B is the wall thickness. Rho C and K are the density, specific heat and thermal conductivity. All of these are constant properties. They are independent of temperature. Now what I can do is I can take this equation T bar equal to e power minus x naught k naught bar times this one and differentiate that and get an expression for the cooling rate. It's in dimensionless form. So the expression for cooling rate is as shown here, where the T is given as T by 2k rho C V square, and the expression for dimensionless cooling rate is as given here, which is which includes the thermal, the dimensionless thermal gradient includes the gradient in the x and the z directions. So you can see that you can calculate the cooling rates and thermal gradients from the Rosenthal solution. And the K1 in the equation is the modified Bessel function of second kind and order one. So now I'm obtaining dimensionless values, but we cannot really look at dimensionless values. We want actual values. So there are relationships to convert dimensionless values to actual values, and they're given, the equations are given here. Now, what do we do here? What we do here is that you see a picture of a molten pool here. Okay. So what we do here is we evaluate the coordinates x and z naught that lie along the boundary of the molten pool using this Rosenthal equation, and by setting the T bar equal to Tm bar, where Tm is the melting temperature of the material. We find out the roots x naught and z naught using MATLAB. So the Rosenthal solution can be implemented by using a software such as MATLAB. Now, using this solution, process maps have been developed. So I'm showing you two process maps here. The one on the left side is the process map for cooling rate, and the one in the middle is a process map for thermal gradient. Here, what we are doing is a process map is a three-dimensional surface plot. You are plotting non-dimensional cooling rate as a function of relative depth within the melt pool and as a function of the melting normal melting temperature. I will explain this result at a later point of time when I compare with experimental observations. But what tells you is that cooling rate varies significantly to the depth of the melt pool, and thermal gradient is relatively insensitive to the depth of the melt pool. Now let us say, for example, you are depositing in kernel 6718 and you have certain process parameters. You want to know what is the ballpark cooling rate, what is the ballpark thermal gradient. You can simply plug into this process map and determine the values of cooling rates and gradients within a matter of minutes. That is the power of this Rosenthal solution. Now I'm going to discuss about the numerical modeling, the FEA part of the LAMP process. So as I've shown earlier, the LAMP process, you need to carry out a thermomechanical analysis. So you have a thermal analysis and a mechanical analysis. And in each step, in thermal analysis and in the mechanical analysis, you have three stages: pre-processing stage, solution stage, post-processing stage. Okay. So you can see that the output of thermal analysis is a thermal field, and the output of the structural analysis is the residual stress or distortion. And we are solving different equations in the thermal stage, and we are solving different equations in the mechanical analysis stages. So So the various steps in the pre-processing stage. In the pre-processing stage, you define the part geometry, you define the material properties as a function of temperature, you define the mesh, you define the initial and boundary conditions, and the applied load, such as the heat flux. Now, what are the material properties that are required? Let us say you are doing the transient thermal analysis. You need to define the thermophysical properties of the material as a function of temperature, such as density, specific heat, thermal conductivity. They have to be defined as a function of temperature. Since there is a phase change from liquid to solid, liquid to solid during solidification, we need to define the latent heat for phase change at the melting point. These are the properties that are required for the transient thermal analysis. For the mechanical analysis, you need to determine elastic modulus, Poisson's ratio, yield strength, and a hardening model. The hardening model can be a bilinear model or a multilinear model. Then you need to define the coefficient of thermal expansion. These are the properties that need to be defined for the mechanical analysis. Now, the meshing. Now, as all of you are aware that the accuracy of the mesh will affect the accuracy of your solution. And very well known from the numerical methods. However, in AM technique, the challenge is what mesh density do we use? Because we are building several layers, thousands of layers, and the number of elements are large in number. They can be in millions. So what kind of mesh density to use? One of the popular techniques that is used in AM is that the mesh density varies from region to region. So what people generally do is they use a fine mesh in the regions near the heat source where the thermal gradients are steep, and you require a fine mesh to accurately capture these gradients. Away from the heat source, where the temperature reaches a steady state, a coarse mesh is generally used. So use different mesh sizes in different regions of the model. Now, one more important aspect is that the solid substrate acts as a heat sink. So now when you are depositing the initial layers, you can have a fine mesh for the substrate itself. But as you are depositing, say, the 100th layer, the effect of the substrate on the temperature distribution in the 100th layer diminishes. Therefore, you can remesh the solid substrate and the initial layers with a coarse mesh. So you can reduce the number of elements in the model. Therefore, the idea is that you are going to use fine mesh in the regions near the heat source and coarse mesh in the regions away from the heat source and also in the regions that have already solidified and whose effect in the vicinity of the melt pool is minimal. Now, once you finish the pre-processing stage, that is, you define the material properties, you define the geometry using the element birth and death technique, and you define the initial condition and the boundary conditions, then you go for the solution stage. In the solution stage, essentially, you are solving the partial differential equations. And you're solving the partial differential equations, which are translated into the global system of equations, the finite element system of equations. Now, you can clearly see that the process is nonlinear. So you have to use either implicit methods or explicit methods for the solution. Generally, implicit methods are used because they are more stable compared to explicit methods, and you can use larger time increments. So the solution stage, you're going to solve the heat conduction equation that was shown earlier. Okay, so you can see the equation. The K is a thermal conductivity matrix, T is a specific heat matrix, and Q is the nodal heat flow vector. And depending upon the inclusion of convection, inclusion of fluid flow, you'll have additional terms to this matrix, to this system of equations. Now, once you finish the thermal analysis, you need to solve the structural analysis to compute the residual stress and distortion. So the first step here is you have to replace the thermal element whose degree of freedom is temperature with a structural element whose degree of freedom is displacement. The structural element should be an elastic one that is capable of handling plaster deformation. So here you should be able to use a hardening model that will capture the nonlinear behavior of the material. The nonlinear mechanical analysis is described by the following finite element equation, where KT is the temperature dependent stiffness matrix and FT is the load vector. So what we do here is, if you do an uncoupled analysis, that is, You first do thermal analysis, followed by mechanical analysis. You take the temperature at each node as a function of time and read it as an input into the structural analysis, and then solve the structural model for displacements. And from displacements, you calculate the strains, and from strains, you calculate the stresses. Okay, so this slide shows the simulation part. And we are simulating the deposition of a thin wall, and you can see the element birth and death technique being used. So the first track is being deposited. In the thin wall geometry, there is only one track in each layer. So you can see subsequent layers being deposited and the thermal temperature contours as the laser or the heat source is moving. Okay. So the main difference is that in the thin wall geometry, you have only one track in each layer. Now, this shows the deposition of a plate geometry where you have multiple tracks in each layer. You can see the movement of the heat source. You're depositing multiple tracks in each layer. Now you're doing the layer number 2, track number 6, and then you're going to layer number 3. So this shows the movement of heat source, the temperature contours. Now, the post-processing stage. In the post-processing stage, you can obtain information such as the dimensions of the melt pool, the shape of the melt pool, which play an important role on the solidification behavior, the maximum temperature, the temperature distribution, the thermal cycling undergone by each layer. Because in additive manufacturing, as you're depositing subsequent layers, the previous layers are being heated and cooled. So they undergo thermal cycling. You can determine the thermal cycling undergone by each layer. You can determine cooling rates. You can determine thermal gradients. And you can also determine the thermal stresses. Now, I'm going to present some case studies that will enable you to understand how computational modeling has been used to understand the characteristics of the deposit in the LAMP processes. So these case studies, there are about 5 case studies. So I'll explain each one and I'll explain the material and the work that we have done here. The first case study was understanding the effect of process variables on deposit characteristics in titanium alloy, titanium 6 aluminium 4 vanadium, which is one of the most popular titanium alloys. And this work was carried out using the directed energy deposition process. So here, what we have done is, on the right hand side, you can see the thin wall geometry that was considered. So we have simulated the deposition of thin wall geometry, and the picture on the left hand corner shows the temperature contours as the number of layers are increasing. You can see that the melt pool dimensions are initially small and they increase as the number of layers increases. This is because when you're depositing the first layer, the substrate acts as a heat sink and it cools very fast. Okay, but as the number of layers increases, the effect of the substrate on diminishes, and the temperature as well as the size of the molten pool increases. So this is shown in layers 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Now, the bottommost picture shows the recycling, the thermal cycling of layers 1 to 10.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, yes.
Sir, no audio is coming. Only slides are changing. Nothing is audible.
A problem from your end.
No, sir. Coming, sir. Audio is okay, sir. I'm able to hear. I think problem your side. Audio is coming.
Yeah, please check that. Please check, because please check that if the problem is at your end. Okay, I'll just continue. So the picture on the bottom shows. Let us consider the last three peaks. The last three peaks. The first peak is when the last four peaks. I'm sorry. The first peak in the blue color is when you are depositing layer 10, the temperature when you are depositing layer number 10. The next peak is the temperature in layer 10 when you are depositing layer number 11. You can see that layer 10 is heated above the melting temperature and cooled. The third peak is the temperature when you are depositing layer 12. The temperature in layer 10 when you are depositing layer 12. You can see that now it's not melted, but it is reheated close to the melting temperature and then cooled. And the last peak is the temperature in layer 10 when you're depositing layer number 13. So you can see that you can predict the reheating of layers, you can predict the melt pool dimensions, you can predict the temperature distribution using the transient thermal analysis. Then what we have done is we have carried out thermomechanical analysis and we have determined the residual stress in the component. So what we have done is we have fabricated some thin wall geometries and we have measured the residual stress using the X-ray diffraction technique. And one important point to understand is one of the advantage of modeling is that with computational modeling, you can determine the magnitude and distribution of residual stress throughout the model. But when you go for a technique like X-ray diffraction, you can only measure at discrete points. So we have measured at certain points and compared the magnitude of the XRD measured value with our simulation value, and we found a decent match. So if you see here, there is a decent agreement between the simulation values and the measured values, and the sign is the same. Next, as I've shown earlier, we have also used the analytical modeling. We are able to generate these process maps. The advantage of these process maps is that they're applicable for any material because you're using constant properties. Now, for example, I am a process engineer and I'm trying to deposit a certain material like a new superalloy. I know the properties, but I want to know what can be the cooling rates and gradients at certain process parameters. I can simply plug in the values here into the TM bar and determine the values from these process maps. And now, one more important point is that how do we determine the grain morphology? So what we can do is we are going to define a new parameter known as solidification velocity R. Solidification velocity R is a ratio of cooling rate to thermal gradient. Okay, we can obtain cooling rate, we can obtain thermal gradients from the finite element model. We can obtain cooling rate and thermal gradients from the Rosenthal solution, but they are in dimensionless form. So what we do, we convert the dimensionless form values into actual values using the thermophysical properties of Ti64 at the melting temperature. Once you know the cooling rates and thermal gradients, you can determine the solidification velocity. Now, certain materials like Ti64, Inconel 718, they have what are known as solidification maps. So you can plot the map. They're also known as the G versus R maps. So you can plot the data on these maps and determine if the grain morphology is going to be equiaxed, columnar, or mixed. So the results here show our modeling predictions compared to experimental observations for thin wall geometries that were deposited using the DED technique, direct energy deposition technique. The left hand result shows the finite element model results. So if you see the G versus R map, it is divided into three regions, fully columnar, mixed, and fully equiaxed. So you can take your thermal gradients and cooling rates obtained from the analytical model and numerical model and plot on this map and determine what is the grain morphology. So for the same conditions that were used experimentally, the numerical results, FEM was predicting a fully columnar morphology for the process conditions considered. The Rosenthal solution, even though it neglects temperature dependency of properties, it neglects latent heat, it's only applicable for infinite or semi-infinite geometries, it assumes quasi-stationary state. With in spite of all these assumptions, it is predicting columnar morphology. And the micrograph, the optical micrograph on the right-hand picture, shows a fully columnar morphology for the lens deposited Ti64. So you can see that the numerical modeling results and the analytical results are in agreement with experimental observations. Now, the advantage of the analytical results is that you can generate the analytical results, Rosenthal results, using MATLAB within a matter of minutes or hours, whereas the numerical results can take some days to run depending upon the complexity. So the power of analytical solution is not to get accurate solution, is to get an idea or a ballpark value of cooling rates and gradients and make decisions based on them. So this is for, again, solidification map predictions for a plate geometry. And on the right hand, the geometry shown on the right corner, that's a plate geometry. Again, the Rosenthal solution assumptions apply. It's an infinite geometry and it's a point heat source. Beneath, you see a micrograph. This is from a paper that was published by researchers at Penn State University in 2003. They observed a mixed morphology. So for the same conditions, we did our numerical modeling, FEM, which predicts an equiaxed microstructure at the surface and a mixed microstructure to the rest of the deposit. So it shows the possibility for a graded microstructure through the depth of the deposit. And that result is in agreement with the experimental observation. The Rosenthal also shows the same. It shows an equiaxed at the surface and a mixed microstructure through the depth of the deposit. So the numerical results are in agreement with analytical results and with experimental observations. So this work has been published. Now I'm going to show a second case study which shows residual stress distribution. So what we have done is we have taken a published paper by people from Penn State in 2017. They have predicted residual stresses in laser deposited in kernel 718 using the direct energy deposition process, and we have compared our model predictions. So this was the geometry that was considered. So you can see that it's a substrate. On top of substrate, you have 10 layers. So we have taken a substrate. We have modeled 10 layers, similar to what has been done in literature, with the same dimensions of the geometry. And this shows the residual stress along the z direction, that is the build direction. So you can see that even though there is a minor variation in the magnitude and distribution of residual stress, the trends are similar. And this minor variation in the magnitude distribution of residual stress we attributed it to neglecting fluid flow in our work. When we neglect the fluid flow due to convection, the convective flows in the melt pool due to buoyancy or mainly due to surface tension, then we are going to overpredict temperatures and overpredict cooling rates. And this would also play a role in the stress distribution. So we are attributing the differences to the neglection of fluid flow in our work. So one of the advantages of numerical model, as you can see here, is that you can predict the stress distribution and magnitude at every point in the model. When you measure it, you have to measure it at discrete points. And also when you're using X-ray diffraction technique, you can only measure through a certain thickness, which is very small, and you have to keep removing material to measure the residual stress through the thickness. And the next slide shows the residual stress along the longitudinal direction. Again, this trend-wise, there is good agreement, except the fact that there is a variation, and that variation could also be attributed to the neglection of fluid flow in our work. Moving to the next slide, we wanted to look at a bimetallic material, like where we are depositing a thin ball or a plate on a different material. So here, you're looking at a case where we deposited tool steel or copper, and we compared our results with experimental work published in the literature. So in the published literature, there's a paper by Tushar et al. Where they have taken tool steel deposit on a copper substrate. So you have the substrate is made up of copper and the deposit is tool steel, and they have used different scanning strategies. Alternative scanning strategy, as you can see here, you traverse from left to right and then you go from right to left. Or unidirectional strategy, you go from left to right and then again you come back to the left position and then again you traverse. So they had a four layer single track H13 tool steel and copper, and we did the same, we took the same geometry and compared our work. So you can see the temperature distribution in the substrate as in the layers, and this is from published work. The left hand side is the published work and the right hand graph is our work. You can see that the temperature distribution that we have shown is very similar to what was published at the same process conditions and at the same scan conditions, thereby validating our process models. You can see the effect of thermal cycling. So you can see the dashed line is substrate. So you can see what is happening when you are depositing layer one, the substrate is being reheated and cooled. When you're depositing layer two, the substrate is being reheated, but temperature is much lower. When you're depositing layer three, you can see the temperature in substrate is much lower. So you can see the effect of reheating also here. So then we also looked at the residual stress distribution along the interface between the substrate and the first layer of H13 at a velocity of 2 mm/s. As you can see, the trend was pretty decently predicted. However, there's a difference in the values. Again, this can be attributed to several factors. The absorption coefficient, the neglection of the powder feed rate, and so on. The next study that I'm presenting is based on the powder bed fusion process. So, since we don't have access to a powder bed fusion machine, we could not actually deposit some components and do the work. So, what we have done is we have compared our results with that were published by by authors called Few et al. In 2014 in an ASME manufacturing science publication. Their study was titled as three-dimensional temperature gradient mechanism in selective laser melting of Ti6 powder. So this is the powder bed fusion process where you spread the powder on the bed and you fuse selectively. So here you can see that what they have done is they have considered five layers. The thickness of each layer is about 30 microns. So the layer thickness is very small. The laser power was they varied from 20 to 80 watts. The scanning speed was about 200 mm per second. The laser spot radius you can see is 26 microns and the layer thickness is 30 microns. So we have taken the same dimensions for layer thickness, for mesh size, and the right hand side can shows our model, and we have carried out our process at the same process parameters. So what they have done is they have considered properties of powder as well as properties of solid to understand the effect of powder compactness on the melt pool geometry. So because, as you know, powder has lower thermal conductivity compared to solid, so they try to understand the effect of compaction of powder on the melt pool. So here they are presenting the effect of laser power on the melt pool width. The left hand plot is from the work of Few et al. Literature, and the right hand one is our work. You can see that they have also measured the melt pool width experimentally, and that has got a statistical variation that's plotted in the form of the error bars. You can see that we have also done the simulations considering only powder and considering solid, and our results are in good agreement with that of published literature. And at the bottom we see our results comparison with the literature results and the percentage error. So again, we have to understand that there are several things that assumptions that we would have made. Okay, so the discrepancy in the results can be attributed to these assumptions that we make in the numerical models. The next slide shows the effect of laser power on melt pool width. Again, we are comparing the results with the Few model, and we were in good agreement with both the powder case and the solid case. And the table on the bottom shows the error in the results between our results and the results published in the literature. Now, as I said earlier, there have been first generation heat source models, analytical models. The second generation heat source models used distributed heat flux and Gaussian heat flux, and other models, the next generation models, are trying to incorporate the fluid flow in the melt pool, the convective flows in the melt pool. Now, the convective flows in the melt pool can be because of buoyancy driven, which is because of density differences in density, or they can be due to electromagnetic force when you use an electron beam process such as Lorentz force, or they can be because of the difference in surface tension. And this is generally known as the Marangoni flow or the thermocapillary flow due to the differences in surface tension. So what we try to do is we try to incorporate the effect of surface tension in a laser surface melting simulation. That is, here there is no deposition, we are only carrying out surface melting. As one of the participants previously asked me a question, we have used our models without the element birth and death technique to carry out the surface melting simulation. So here we have incorporated properties such as viscosity, surface tension, in addition to the thermophysical properties as density, specific heat, and thermal conductivity. So here we have carried out the laser surface melting experiments using a powder bed fusion machine. So the laser is controlled by the Galvanov scanner, and the remelted tracks are there. So you can see the finite element model. We have used the finite volume technique. The boundary conditions are convection on all the faces. Ambient temperature is taken as 25 degrees centigrade or 298 K. A Gaussian heat flux was used. And the picture shows the melt pool cross section in the ZZ plane, the melt pool width, and the melt pool depth. So you can see the laser surface melting simulation that is shown on the right hand side. And here, what we have done is the charts are quite busy. So let me explain what's happening. We are plotting the melt pool width and as a function of scan speed at different laser powers. And we are plotting melt pool depth as a function of scan speed at different laser powers. Now, there are two models here. One model is only solving for the heat conduction equation, that is without the fluid flow. And the second model incorporates convective effects and fluid dynamics effects, that is with the fluid flow. As you can see here, the model incorporating fluid flow, the results from this model, both for melt pool width and melt pool depth, they are in much better agreement with the experimental results when compared to the model that only takes into account the heat conduction. As I said earlier, neglection of fluid flow or neglection of convective flows in the melt pool will result in overprediction of temperatures, higher maximum peak temperatures, and overprediction of cooling rates. So this study illustrated to us the importance of incorporating fluid flow in our studies. So as we go forward in our computational models, we are planning to incorporate fluid flow in our actual deposition models also. So the plot on the bottom shows the maximum peak temperature that is predicted as a function of scan speed with and without the fluid flow. You can see that when you, without the fluid flow is the dashed lines and with flow is the solid lines. You can see that with fluid flow, we are predicting lower peak temperatures in the melt pool. Again, if you look at here, this plot shows the velocity fields in the melt pool shape. You can clearly see here that the left hand side is the optical micrograph that is superposed with the melt pool contours from the finite element simulation. You can see that the contours with the fluid flow are in better agreement when compared to the contours without the fluid flow. The contours with the fluid flow are in graph A, and you can see a better agreement when compared to the contours without the fluid flow in graph B. And the velocity field vectors that will enable us to determine the direction of fluid flow in the melt pool due to surface tension are given. You can see that the direction of heat transfer is from the heat source to the bottom of the melt pool. So heat is being transferred from the heat source to the bottom, resulting in a melt pool that is deeper and narrower. So I would like to summarize my presentation here. So as I said, laser additive manufacturing process, including both the direct energy deposition process and powder bed fusion process, they are under consideration for aerospace, biomedical, and tooling applications, but mainly for aerospace applications because they offer increases in efficiency and flexibility compared to conventional manufacturing process, particularly the buy-to-fly ratio, that is the amount of material you start with and the amount that actually ends up in a part. The buy-to-fly ratio conventional process is about 20:1, whereas with the additive process it is about 1:1 or 1:2. Now, in additive process, a complex thermal history is experienced by the deposited part. This complex thermal history determines the residual stress and the microstructure. To determine the complex thermal history, computational modeling can be useful tool. Now, the management of residual stress and resulting distortion is a critical factor for the widespread adoption of additive manufacturing process. And in this work, we primarily discussed about the need for computational modeling, the challenges in the computational modeling of the process, the different computational models available, starting from the particle size to the micro size, particle size, the mesoscale and the macro scale, then elaboration of the challenges in the modeling, including the element birth and death technique, the heat input, the accounting for the heat transfer, thermomechanical coupling, and I also shown case studies where we have determined melt pool dimensions, cooling rates, thermal gradients. We have used analytical solution to obtain process maps, and in one of the recent studies, we have used fluid flow to understand the convective flows in the melt pool. So future work can increase the complexity of the computational models by incorporating powder flow rate and also the convective flows within the melt pool during the deposition. So I thank you all for your time and attention. I thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to share my experience, my work, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving a wonderful session on simulation of this laser additive manufacturing process. I would like to ask participants, if there are any questions, please ask the speaker.
Hello, good afternoon, sir. Sir, you have done a finite element modeling for in many cases. So, sir, I'm asking, what is the scope of molecular level simulation for laser additive manufacturing process, like MDS, molecular dynamics simulation?
See, there is scope, because as I said earlier, if you really want to accurately predict the particularly solidification microstructure, you need to go to the particle, the micro scale. And at the micro scale, you have to do phase field simulations and all. That can be done using the Monte Carlo techniques or molecular dynamics simulations and all. So I think the right approach is going to be the ICME approach, the integrated computational metals engineering approach, where you do simulations at different length scales and you integrate the results from the simulations. So that would be the appropriate approach. But if you are looking at only understanding the temperature, temperature distribution and residual stress, the meso and the macro scales would be sufficient. But if you really want to predict the dendrite arm spacing, the grain coarsening effects, solid state phase transformations and all, you have to go into the micro scale simulations and all. And that, for that, I think the best approach is to do simulations at different length scales and integrate them with the other length scales.
Okay, sir. So one more question. This surface roughness modeling. How can we model was regarding the surface roughness in laser surface processing process? You explained the laser surface melting model. So in this case, we can model for modeling simulation for roughness value.
See, honestly speaking, we have not tried that, but I will just maybe give an answer saying that we have considered a non-deformed surface. If you consider a deformed surface, you will be able to handle that situation.
Yes, I understand. Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, hello, sir. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Sir, how easily one can adopt the, if you have a casting simulation model, can we adopt it to this particular additive manufacturing for thermal analysis?
Can you please elaborate on that? When you say casting simulation model means?
Suppose if you have a solidification simulation, say for a purpose of feeder design or other thing, say when you do a thermal analysis, for the solidification of casting component, can we modify it to or fine tune it to a bit, and can it be adopted to this, or it has a more deviation?
I have not seen any studies where they have done this kind of adoption of a casting simulation model to an AM model. There is a significant difference between casting and AM in terms of the melt pool size. In AM, you have a very small localized melt pool, whereas in casting, you have a molten region. So that difference itself could play a significant role, because you have a very localized melt pool that solidifies rapidly. You have a rapid heating and cooling in the additive manufacturing process and very small melt pool. But in casting, you have a molten metal in a mold. So I'm not sure if the casting model can be used for AM simulations. But in the published work, I have not come across anyone, whatever I know, because there is so much of volume of literature being published, I may not be able to keep a track of everything. But from what little I have seen, I have not seen anybody taking a casting model and trying to change things for additive manufacturing.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, good afternoon again. So that was a fantabulous presentation. Thank you. Sir, in the first case study, where you shown the melt pool sizes in between the layers, right? Now they're from the bottom layer to the top layer. As you move up, your melt pool size was increasing. But what I understand is that melt pool size will directly affect the microstructure, if I'm not wrong. Am I right, sir?
Yes. Melt pool size has an effect on build conditions as well as microstructure.
Okay, so given the melt pool size to be smaller, your induced microstructure would be finer, right? Finer grain size. Will that go good?
See, the thing is, as the melt pool size, rephrase your question. What you are saying is, you are seeing an increase in the melt pool size as the number of layers increases, and you're asking if the melt pool size will have an effect on microstructure.
More precisely, like as you go up the layer, whether your grain size was becoming coarser.
We have not done a very systematic study on sectioning the grain, the microstructure at different regions of the build. My point is that the size, the increase in melt pool size is occurring because of the diminished effect of substrate. As you're increasing the number of layers, what is happening is the substrate effect is diminishing, and the cooling rate reduces, and the temperature increases, and the molten pool size increases. Now, there is one more reason why the molten pool size can increase in the AM process, and that reason is when you are reaching a free edge. When you reach a free edge, the area available for heat conduction changes, and your melt pool size increases. Both the situations will affect your solidification behavior. One of the things that the OEMs are trying to do, the original equipment manufacturers are trying to do, is that they are trying to develop a closed loop feedback control, so that whenever they observe an increase in the melt pool size, that is immediately prevented by changing the process parameters, so that you obtain a consistent steady state melt pool size for consistency in build conditions as well as in microstructure.
Decreasing the laser power immediately.
Yes. The moment you see an increase in the melt pool size, you decrease the laser power so that you maintain a consistency in the melt pool size. The problem is, if you cannot control the melt pool size, you cannot control the size of the feature that.
बेटे तूफ़ानी खाना.
If you cannot control the melt pool size, you cannot control the size of the feature that you can build using the process. Therefore, the control of melt pools is assumed the highest priority within the manufacturing community.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you very much.
Hello. Sir, I am audible, sir.
Yeah, you're audible. Please go ahead.
Okay, sir. My question is regarding the first case study which you have shown, that is TA64, the specimen, the picture of the specimen experimentally determined. Sir, please tell us what is the range of particle size, powder particle size you have used in that?
Thin wall geometry was deposited using the direct energy deposition process, and the particle size was between 50 to 100 microns.
Okay. What is the shape of the particle, sir? Is it spherical or any irregular shape?
It is mostly spherical, with some satellites that sticking on the spherical particles, but it is spherical.
Okay. And sir, you have the in-house facility in NIT Suratkal?
Honestly speaking, we don't have either of these two processes, but we are currently in the process of buying a DED machine, direct energy deposition based technique. We may be acquiring it, but we have been collaborating with institutions to collaborate with them for the deposition of geometries involved.
Okay. Sir, instead of using a micro size powder, if I use a nano size powder in the same case, what you have done, do you think will there any be key difference in the microstructure, or will there be any key difference in mechanical properties?
First thing is I've not done anything on the nano size powders, and also I'm not sure how, if I can comment correctly on it. But one challenge will be the flowability will be a problem. As the size of the powder particles decreases, the frictional forces will increase. So flowability becomes an extremely problem. Flowability becomes very problematic.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
And then catchment efficiency will change. So a lot of other things come into picture. That's why in DED you have a certain size range.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Sir, there is one question in chat box.
Yeah, please go ahead.
What is the effect of varying laser spot radius on mechanical and metallurgical properties in powder bed fusion process?
what is
effect? Is there any special MATLAB?
See, this is in Powder Bed Fusion process, no?
Yes, yes.
So yeah, the as you vary the laser spot radius, you will be changing the energy density that's available. So higher energy density, as we all know, will lead to better bonding between layers and would reduce the lack of fusion porosity and all. So we have ourselves not done any experimental or simulation studies in that regard. So my general answer would be is that if you increase the energy density by reducing the spot size, you'll probably have lower lack of fusion porosity and better bonding between layers.
Sir, they are asking, is there any special toolbox in MATLAB for RT manufacturing?
I have not seen any special toolbox in MATLAB, but as you said, maybe they may be incorporating because of the number of people.
The recent manufacturing toolbox in the MATLAB, sir.
Okay, yeah, I have not seen that. I'm sorry, I have not seen that. So maybe, yeah.